Hi, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore. Today's program is on thyroid power, 10 steps to total health. Our special guest is Dr. Richard Shames and Karilee Halo Shames, RN, PhD, who I guess to both Dr. Shameses, to talk about the role of the Shamus, to talk about the role of thyroid in the whole issue of health, talking about its role in health, its role in disease, and ways in which you can use thyroid power to overcome a number of the problems which you may or may not recognize. So we want to welcome the Dr. Shamus to our program. Thank you very much for joining us once again. Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, can you hear us?
We can hear you now.
Okay, we're happy to be with you.
All right, good to have you. I think we had you here once before, and we appreciated that visit so much. I asked Ranjita to get you back again. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you. It's a very important topic.
Let's talk a little bit about the thyroid. Can you, Dr. Shamus, explain, Dr. Richard Shamus, explain to us where the thyroid is and what its role is in health?
Sure. The thyroid is a small gland at the base of the throat. Right near the Adam's apple. But it's one of the most important glands in the body. This little gland is the gas pedal for everything else that happens and everything else that you do. So the thyroid is your energy for life. And if you don't have it, you don't do much of anything. You don't have enough energy, or you get sick a lot, or nothing else seems to work. You get depressed, you get tired, you don't sleep well, you're chilly and cold. I mean, there's a long, long list of problems that people get with low thyroid that seem to be unrelated, because thyroid affects every system in the body, everything from constipation to brittle nails, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, low sex drive, people who have bad eyesight or bad hearing or gum problems. I mean, the list is very long. In fact, anything, any illness could be a reflection of low thyroid.
How does the thyroid do what it does?
It creates a hormone that goes into every cell. If you did not have a thyroid, some people have an accident, the thyroid is ripped out, well, you would die. If you don't have thyroid hormone, your cells do not run. Every cell in your body needs thyroid hormone for the replication of the DNA into the RNA, which then goes into the cells as proteins and enzymes.
And what is it we measure when we look at it? You know, everybody talks about the T3 and the T4, but there are a number of thyroid tests that people need to know about, don't they, in order to understand what the level and confidence of their thyroid gland is.
Well, I'll start with what doctors generally order. Most doctors, if they will order any test, order a TSH, which is a thyroid-stimulating hormone test. This test has been shown to be not quite as accurate or as helpful as some of the other ones that Dr. Rich will tell you about in a minute. One of the things that's exciting to us is that just within the past couple of years, the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists has changed their standards for what constitutes having a thyroid problem. They have made it more conservative, so that instead of people who had very high numbers before, such as 5.0, were considered to be normal. Now, if you're 3.0 or higher, they consider that to be a problem.
That's on the TSH?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And you see, the TSH is just one of many tests. What Karilee is talking about is the tests for thyroid are not good enough. People are given tests and said, oh, you're fine. And it's been found in the recent medical studies that the current tests that we have for thyroid are not good. They're not as good as they should be. You could still be low thyroid even with normal tests. That's what we want to let your listeners know about, that many people are being misdiagnosed, people in the HMOs, people in different clinics around the country. They're told, oh, your thyroid is fine, but it's not. That's as, even if it's tested, you could still be low thyroid even with normal tests.
Well, if you can't use normal tests, you know, being kind of the pragmatist that I am, what do you use to make the diagnosis
right
of thyroid? Just giving people thyroid?
Well, no, sir.
No, you listen. You can certainly do some excellent tests. Karilee will tell you a little bit about other things.
Well, what I want to say is that it's not just the tests. What we're saying is that to do what we feel is good medicine is to look at the patient in front of you, so that you're not only treating the lab results, you're actually treating the person. Many times people go into the doctor and they have a laundry list of symptoms, but the doctor says, I'm sorry that your hair is falling out, that your nails are all broken, that you're having painful periods, that you're having migraines, that you feel terrible, but your thyroid is normal according to our tests, therefore we won't treat you. What we're saying is let's look at some other aspects of the person, let's, in addition to the lab testing, and then look at it as a whole picture, and then treat the whole person. So treating the whole person means looking at signs and symptoms, related conditions, and associated illnesses that you may have that frequently coexist with the thyroid problem. And also looking at the family history, which is very important. Thyroid is a very hereditary illness. So when someone in your family has had a thyroid condition...
Or even diabetes.
Right. Another autoimmune condition, because low thyroid and high thyroid are actually autoimmune conditions. And when those exist, often they exist in concert with others. So we're trying to sort of peel back the onion and look at the whole patient and make sure that we're not missing something very important.
How do you guard against the, you know, I've been through several periods of variety of different particular approaches to health that focused on one or two dynamics. Of course, you go through the Manelia, you go through a whole variety of Epstein-Barr, you go through a whole variety of things. And certainly I've seen thyroid is proposed for just about every condition, medical condition that you can imagine. How do you guard against the placebo effect of what you do, or do you care?
Well, sure. Listen, it's not so much guarding against the placebo effect. There many times people will be given something for a condition. People have fatigue, depression, overweight, dry hair, dry skin, dry eyes. There are a lot of problems that people will go to a doctor and they'll be given something that might be akin to a placebo that maybe it'll help for a week or two. But one of the things about thyroid medicine is that it is effective and it stays effective. Placebos often wear out after a while. It's a known fact that when person is low in thyroid and they're given thyroid, that benefit continues. That could continue for years. See, you know, the Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center in New York did a survey and very careful research. They found out that there's over 20 million people who are already being treated for thyroid in this country. The University of Colorado Health Sciences followed up with that, with the Harvard professor. They found out that as many as 1 in 10 Americans could have some degree of thyroid low function. And then just in a year 2001, the Journal of Epidemiology found that 26%, as many as 26% of menopausal women in the United States had low thyroid. Now, this is the sort of thing where it's an enormous epidemic. So we are, on the one hand, being told by some doctors, oh, you're looking at this, as if this thyroid is everywhere. Well, it turns out it is everywhere. It's a massive undeclared epidemic, and millions of people are suffering needlessly. Now, we don't want to give people thyroid as if it's a placebo, but when you give them thyroid and it works and it keeps working and it keeps on working and working for a year or two or three, well, that's no longer a placebo.
Can you ethically give thyroid to a person whose thyroid function studies are normal?
I have indeed given thyroid to a person whose thyroid function studies are normal, because the thyroid function studies that we have that are generally used, that are the HMOs use, is, that's what Karilee said, is like the TSH. A TSH thyroid function study has been recently debunked as being not good enough to find out all the people who are low in thyroid. It's very useful if you're terribly low. It's very useful if you're terribly high. But for the millions of people who are suffering with these the mild illnesses, like I said, everything from the low sex drive to high cholesterol that might be thyroid related, and if they're treated with antidepressants or they're treated with these cholesterol drugs that affect the liver, when really it could be something much more benign. Thyroid medicines are extremely benign, and I, yes, have done a clinical trial, and when the person, for instance, has a mother, an aunt, and a sister who are low thyroid, she has fatigue and depression and overweight, as well as something like low sex drive and high cholesterol. I very often give that person a chance to see if thyroid hormone will change their life for the better. When it does, I stick with it. If it seems to last for a long time, I figure we're not working with the placebo. We may have found a diagnosis.
We're talking with Dr. Richard Seamus and Karilee Halo Seamus, also a RN, PhD. We're talking about the book Thyroid Power, 10 Steps to Total Health, the amazing program to help millions conquer fatigue, depression, overweight, and other chronic conditions. If you want to join us, as always, our number in the 510 area code is 848-4425. That's 848-4425. So join us. This program is always called the least expensive second opinion in town. You got a chance to talk with thyroid experts and to get some information that you might not be able to get other places. And certainly, you can get this information very easily. How do people realize, what people sitting out listening to our program, what are some of the things that, specific things that you think they should be thinking about in relationship to thyroid?
You mean in terms of diagnosis?
Just in terms of symptoms that they have themselves. I mean, more common ones.
Common symptoms are fatigue, depression, gaining weight, even when you're eating sensibly and unable to lose it. Very easy to gain, very hard to lose. This is very common. Being tired is a big one.
Sure, and then gum problems, mood swings, choking sensations, or difficulty swallowing. A lot of people have very difficult time. Sometimes the piece of food will get caught, or sometimes they'll have trouble even getting all their vitamins down. The thyroid is right wrapped around the throat and the voice box. Hoarseness is a common symptom. Feeling off balance. You know, a great many women who have fertility problems, it's really a thyroid problem. Many, many miscarriages would be helped if it were diagnosed that the thyroid was there. So the problems with memory, focus, concentration, dropouts in stamina throughout the day, the people have all kinds of things. Prematurely gray hair is sometimes related, mitral valve prolapse, carpal tunnel syndrome. These are a few of the things. A lot of folks are just chilly all the time, or they're heat intolerant. The thyroid is your thermostat in the body, and it controls your temperature and so forth. So a lot of people walking around chilly or chilly at night, or they're sweating at night because they just don't have good temperature regulation. You got to think thyroid.
So it might be a good idea.
A lot of people have this and just don't realize it, and it wreaks havoc with their life. Then they think they're a little crazy because they have so many symptoms like the ones Richard has just mentioned. But the truth is that if you understand that the thyroid is like the furnace that drives everything else in the body. It sends thyroxine hormone into every cell of your body, and that actually drives the mitochondria at the very cellular level, so that it begins to make a little more sense. Oh, that's why this particular organ might be slowing down, or that's why my whole system. Constipation is a big one. A lot of people say, oh, well, I've always been constipated. If they've always been constipated, it may be that the body is conserving energy the best way it knows how, and that is to kind of slow down some of the organs that are not being driven. The thyroid is just not driving all the organs properly. And so that sort of explains, you know, some people will have other symptoms and certain people will have different symptoms. So,
sure. A big one is hair loss. So many women are come to my office. I have an office in San Rafael, and I'm practicing general practice. And one of the biggest problems I see in my general practice is women coming in distressed about hair loss that the dermatologist says, no, there's no reason for it. And then the GP says, well, we've checked everything. You're not anemic, and your thyroid tests are normal. And they're losing hair. The hair is thinning. And it's almost, you know, they have visions of it getting thinner and thinner and maybe losing their hair completely. And it's not like this terrible problem like someone else would have cancer and someone else will have a failing heart. But this is very distressing frequently. It's low thyroid, undiagnosed, undetermined by tests, but a thyroid trial often does a great job.
Now, there were many studies where they took a group of people and just kind of a cluster and gave them prophylactic thyroid to see if their overall health and well-being was better.
There have been a couple of studies like that, and because there are so many undiagnosed low thyroid people in the community, those studies are often been very, very revealing. In fact, the reason the normal tests, the reason the people have trouble getting a test for thyroid and being told you're normal is that so many low thyroid people were undiagnosed and not know they had thyroid, and then were given, they were in the study, they were part of the cohort of a study, to find out what was the normal range. So you take 1,000 normal people and you pool all their results and you say, well, this is the range. And the TSH range was 0.5 to 5. Well, it turned out the upper end of that range was a bunch of people who should not have been in the cohort as normal. They were people who were borderline low thyroid, but nobody knew it. Their doctors didn't know it. They didn't know it. And so they got as part of the normal range, and now you compare yourself to them. You're borderline low thyroid, but you're called normal because they were in part of that study. This has been recently evaluated in the medical journals.
All right. Our book is The Thyroid Power, 10 Steps to Total Health. Our guests are Richard and Karilee Seamus. If you want to join us, 848-4425 is our number in the 510 area code, 848-4425. Let's start off with Barbara in Sonoma. You're on About Health.
I'm so glad that you're talking about this. I was diagnosed with Hashimoto's thyroiditis just before I had...
Can you turn your radio down for us, please, Barbara?
It's not on.
Oh, it's not on. Okay.
Yeah, I was diagnosed with Hashimoto's just before having surgery, and the standard doctors played the, well, we'll just take care of this later kind of game, which for me was a huge mistake because apparently the thyroid not working right put me where I have anomalous reactions to other drugs. And my brother is now facing, he also has Hashimoto's, and is being told, well, you're just a little low on your thyroid and, you know, eat right, sleep well, and you'll be just fine. If you would please speak to both the Hashimoto's and the how do you work with standard doctors or with people that have that believe what they're being told of, oh, well, just, you know, manage your stress and you're fine, honey.
In fact, Dr. Seamus does coaching, thyroid coaching for people all over the country based on our website, which is thyroidpower.com. That's www.thyroidpower.com. And what we're hearing this story over and over. I cannot tell you how many times we've heard that story, and it breaks our heart because we know that people are suffering, and then they go in and the doctor kind of tells them it's all in your head. It's very difficult to deal with doctors in this situation because many of them do not want to listen, and they don't really understand the thyroid as well as we do, only by default.
Yeah, I'm a medical professional and go home and quit bugging me.
What's that?
The attitude of I'm a medical professional and I know more than you.
Yes, and this is not an important topic. That's what's so amazing to us is doctors say, look, I'm doing important work. Don't bother me about this little thyroid thing. This little thyroid thing underlies so much other illness. And especially you mentioned surgery, and I'm really glad that you did because many times when people, that is one of the trigger points. There are several times in our lives when we usually find out that we have a thyroid problem. Those times are puberty, childbirth, menopause, or after some kind of crisis or trauma, and surgery fits into that category.
Yeah, I was to the point of losing my mind. I had was considering suicide, and the additional for me was that I am T4 intolerant.
Oh, yeah.
So I had to go through all the T4 craziness before I could find T3 as a... And if you would speak to that as well, and I'll listen to my answer on the radio.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Barbara.
Sure. Now, Barbara from Sonoma, listen, I'm very interested in this. My practice is in San Rafael, and I tell you, I have... maybe it's something about Sonoma and Marin County, but there's so much Hashimoto's that's going around now. It doesn't occur in families, just like Barbara, their brother had it, and I see people whose cousins and aunts and the mothers and fathers and so forth. The whole thing about Hashimoto's is that it is autoimmune, meaning that your own immune system is hampering the effectiveness of an important gland in your body. Usually the immune system is fighting things that are outside, by viruses and bacteria that are outside and coming in at you. Or maybe your immune system is doing something a little silly, like getting all worried and hepped up about pollen, dust, and mold. But it's very, very odd and strange for the immune system to start bugging one of your own glands and one of your own body tissues. But certain people have the tendency for it. It occurs in families of people who have diabetes in the family or rheumatoid arthritis or any of the autoimmune illnesses. You're very liable to have low thyroid Hashimoto's, low thyroid is the name of it, as a concomitant to whatever else you're going through. And like I say, it causes everything from the high cholesterol to low sex drive. It's very well known that it causes reactions to medicines that are unusual. A person with Hashimoto's doesn't do well with the standard antidepressants for depression. A person with Hashimoto's, I mean, in my San Rafael practice, I have lots and lots of allergy people who are not getting help with the standard allergy medicines. They just don't work as well. They have problems with, they heal a little bit differently and more slowly. They'll take a medicine for digestion, and instead of helping the digestion, it makes it worse.
You know, when we go through this broad range of symptoms, it's very difficult to avoid the thyroid in any clinical condition if we take this approach. There must be a more narrow way to look at this in such a way that it does have some semblance of real science. If you talk about all the symptoms that you've just described across the spectrum, I mean, everybody in this audience has one or two of those symptoms. Now, conceivably, they could be thyroid, and if that could be measured, that would be one thing. But if you're telling us that the measurements are not accurate, let me finish with my question. There has to be some way to narrow this focus, because what I've heard is everything from gastroenterology to, I've been an allergist for 30 years. I've never heard thyroid connected to the allergy until today, but there's got to be some group of symptoms that you're much more comfortable with than all of these others.
Well, sure. Listen, a person who has fatigue, a person who has some temperature difficulty, and if there's any problem with the outer surface, like the very dry skin or losing hair, especially the outer third of the eyebrows, but hair loss or the nails that get cracked and peel easily or don't grow well or they have ridges, you know, the outer surface of the body. The thyroid is very well known for doing this, but when you talk about narrowing the focus, you can get some special tests. The TSH is just the very broad net, but if you get tests like a free T3 and a free T4, well, then those tests often do reveal a low thyroid problem. But the HMOs, many of them, for instance, Kaiser is one that's a very large HMO that they don't do that test. They just do a TSH or maybe a free T4, which is not a very useful test. It's a free T3 or a total T3, or taking just the simple thing of taking your temperature. You take your temperature in the morning, and if you're not 98 or above, then you may have a thyroid problem. There's a good way of narrowing the focus down.
All right, let's go to George in Corte Madera. You're on About Health.
Well, I think he may have just answered my question. I would really like to find out what the most dependable test for low thyroid is.
That's a great question. And what Dr. Shamas just said is the free T3 and the free T4 are often very helpful. There's also the total T3.
Yeah, the total T3 is probably one of the better tests and most underutilized. And so a doctor will give you a T4 test or a TSH and say, look, I want to test the T3. I want to test the T3. And a total T3 or a free T3, those are good tests. Not the T3 uptake, but maybe it's best if it rhymes. Here's the rhyme. Free T3, like free as a bird, but T3. So a free T3 is probably one of the better tests that we have. And if you've done the regular tests and it's normal, but you still have family or have it, or you still have the symptoms and you're still suspicious, you ask for a free T3, and that could narrow this down and maybe pin down the diagnosis.
If you wanted to, if say it was a situation where you had an HMO or somebody who didn't want to do this, how much would a free T3 cost just for if the individual wanted it, or if you want to order it even without the direction of the HMO?
Right. You could probably get that on your own. I think it's possible that it's over $100. I know that. I'm not sure of the exact price, but it could be well worth it because it ends. In my San Rafael practice, I've found that people who have been having difficulty for years, one unsuccessful treatment of a nagging disorder followed by another unsuccessful treatment of another nagging disorder, and then they find out that they did have a thyroid problem after all, and a lot of that is now gone, dissipated. People have had years and years of difficulty fade away. It's been one of the most satisfying fields of medicine to practice. I'm a general practitioner. I practice all kinds of fields. But the thyroid field has been one of the most satisfying to me because of the long-term benefit and the total turnaround of years and years of difficulty. That's why on our website, the thyroidpower.com website, we have case histories of people that have changed their life for the better. And testimonials. I mean, there are people that have really done better.
Also, to round things out a little bit, there's another way to test for some of this that is less expensive, and that would be some saliva testing. Now, I know that saliva testing has not been endorsed or embraced yet by the regular medical community. However, the saliva test for HIV has just been approved by the United Nations as a way to test people all over the world for AIDS. So we're now moving to something that we have long embraced, and our next book is going to even talk more about, and that would be the spot testing. It's called the blood spot test. You can actually get a kit from ZRT Labs in Beaverton, Oregon, ZRT, and that's Dr. David Zava, that basically you prick your own finger with a kit that they give you with sterile spring-loaded item in there that just pricks your finger, and then you put some blood spots on a piece of paper and you mail that into them. They do a wonderful job of checking your thyroid levels very reasonably.
All right, we'll get that address for you again. Let's go. 848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code. Our guests are the Dr. Seamus. We're talking about thyroid power, 10 steps to total health. We're going to be talking about where a natural thyroid occurs, how you determine what your dose is. But let's first talk to you. Let's go to Ruth in Napa. You're on About Health.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thanks for taking my call.
Ruth, is your radio turned down?
Yeah, I don't have my radio on.
I guess it must be feedback in our own system. But go ahead.
Okay. I had thyroid cancer a number of years ago. And since then, I mean, I'm just listening to all of these things you're describing. You know, I've had depression. I've had weight gain. I've developed eczema. All of these different things. And I'm with an HMO, and my doctors tell me that my thyroid level is where it should be because I've asked them to check it again because ever since the surgery, I don't feel right.
I cannot tell you how many times we hear exactly what you said. That could be the title of our next book. Ever since that blank, but in this case, most often it's surgery, I just don't feel right. Many times that happens to people even when it wasn't thyroid surgery because the body gets depleted from trying to heal from a stressful surgery and there's not enough thyroid hormone. However, in your situation, did they take your gland out?
Yes.
And you're not taking thyroid medicine?
Yes, I do take it.
Okay.
And I've asked them to check the level because
But you don't remember what those levels are at this point.
The amount that I'm taking?
No, the amount, where you fall. In other words, when they check your levels, they probably use the TSH test that we've been talking about.
Yeah, and I don't remember what the
level
was.
Which in itself is not the best diagnostic tool.
Mm-hmm.
We would recommend some of the ZRT. I think if you go to salivatest.com, you can learn a lot more about the blood testing and the saliva testing. But
TSH has been reevaluated.
Yeah, because the TSH has been reevaluated. But many times, you know, people, especially with surgery, would need supplementation of both the T3 and T4. That means in addition to taking some form of thyroid medicine,
uh-huh.
You might want to take the active component of thyroid hormone. Some people find that they do better with that or with a combination. I'm one of those people. I was about 60% improved, and I felt better, but I didn't feel like my old self. And then when I went to UC Med Center and started talking with the top endocrinologist there, I was put on Cytomel, which is the T3 component, is the active thyroid hormone. Sometimes our bodies just don't convert the inactive form into the active form as well as it should.
And most people are taking the inactive form.
Yeah, most people are taking the inactive form. If you're taking Synthroid,
right? Yes.
Yeah, which most people in America take Synthroid. It's one medicine. Just so you know, there are 12 different types of thyroid medicine. Half of them are natural, and half of them are synthetic. for reasons that we don't fully understand yet, sometimes people do better on the synthetic than the natural. Some people do better on the natural than the synthetic. And if you're not feeling well, one of the first things to do is to try a different type of thyroid hormone. That could be Westroid, Euthroid, Natrothroid, Biothroid, Unithroid. There's a whole slew of medicines that most doctors know nothing about, and they only give Synthroid.
Mm-hmm.
So those would be some of the places that we'd recommend. First of all, maybe considering getting better testing done with the total T3 and the
free T3.
Yes, but in my San Rafael practice, I have people like yourself who have had, for one reason or another, a thyroid surgery. It's not always cancer that you have the thyroid taken out. Sometimes hyperthyroid people have had their thyroid removed, ablated, or radioactive iodine, and they have no thyroid function. You're a person whose gland has been taken out for cancer. You have no thyroid function. Now, people like this often don't convert the T4 that is in Synthroid or these other standard medicines, like Karilee's saying, into T3, as well as they should. Also, many of the people in my practice, I do a medical practice that many people don't do well on synthetic medicine. Synthroid is synthetic thyroid. People often do better on natural thyroid if they've had a gland taken out. It's because the gland makes T1 and T2, and you don't have any T1 and T2, even if you're doing the T3, T4 combo. So and the thyroid makes other kinds of things the thyrocalcitonin is an item that the thyroid gland makes that you don't have it at all if your thyroid gland has been taken out. So if you take some animal thyroid gland, you get to have some of those other ingredients. It's kind of like a baby being nursed on the breast rather than just a synthetic formula. A lot of babies do better on the animal milk rather than the synthetic formula.
And also there are minerals and vitamins that can help you to boost your thyroid power as well. We recommend some of those on our website and in our book. And Dr. Shamus also does thyroid coaching with people through our website so that if somebody needs specific care and they just know that they're not feeling quite right, sometimes it can be a mineral. Selenium and zinc are very, very important and critical to thyroid function, as well as a well-rounded, high-quality health food product that could be a multi-mineral, multivitamin to make sure you have everything you need to run your body smoothly.
And one of the things that I'm sure that many of your clients or people that you talk to around the country experience is, how do you talk to your doctor about this kind of thing? I mean, if you're in a situation where you have you established a relationship with a primary care doctor, you feel that you may have a thyroid-related issue, and that doctor doesn't feel it for all the reasons that you just mentioned, what are some of the tips people can use in talking with their primary care providers to kind of get more attention paid to the thyroid?
You've hit a real raw nerve there, Dr. Lenore. You've hit the nail on the head as far as what the biggest challenge we're up against right now. And that is, if you come across as really knowledgeable, which many, when we wrote Thyroid Power, people wrote us and thanked us profusely and then went off to their doctors, and we even wrote a section called Show This to Your Doctor, and found out that a lot of the doctors didn't want to read it, didn't believe in any of this, because we recommend including natural protocols along with the traditional medicinal ones. And so many times, you know, you can come across as a very knowledgeable and empowered health consumer, and your doctor will maybe just not receive that well. It may not be anything you're doing. It may be an attitude, but so you've got to be real careful with your attitude. But if you feel you've come across just as being assertive and your doctor is kind of touchy about it, you might want to shop around and see if you can find someone. There are websites that link to ours that will tell you other places where you can find doctors. This is a big problem because a lot of doctors don't want to deal with the thyroid. And the truth is, to be honest with you, a lot of them don't know how to make you feel better. And instead of saying that, they just get a little huffy and kind of defensive.
But here's something that is
good. We also teach seminars for physicians and practitioners in addition to talking to consumers, and we're trying to bridge that gap.
Yeah, here's something that on the Thyroid Power website, or in the book, Thyroid Power, that 10 Steps to Total Health. There are, in this section called Show This to Your Doctor, I want you to now know that it is our recommendation not to show anything to your doctor except a medical journal article. So if you can download from the website, never say to a doctor, internet or webs, or, you know, just download an article or go to the medical library and get an article. And on our website or in our book, Thyroid Power, we list many of the articles that we're referring to today on the air. For this information. We didn't come up with this information. This is all good research in peer-reviewed medical journals. What you do is you show the doctor the peer-reviewed medical journal article. You actually mention it. If you can't get the actual article or the abstract, you just cite it. You say it's the Journal of the American Medical Association, 1999, volume 4, page so-and-so. And then that is something that a doctor can look at very quickly. Or you can even just copy these articles and bring them in and say, look, here is an article that says that using natural thyroid can be helpful in people who've had their thyroid gland removed. And then you get to try it. You say, look, here's an article. I want to try what this article is suggesting. I know it's not y'all standard practice yet, but work with me on this. So if you can show a doctor a journal article and then say, just, you know, work with me on this, I think you get a better shot at it.
Now that's good response. Bob in San Anselmo, you're on About Health.
Hi. I was wondering if Dr. Shamus had seen any of the sleep restriction deprivation experimental literature, particularly by Dr. Eve Van Catter out of the University of Chicago. And she has found that just restricting people's sleep by 2 hours a night over a period of 10 days disrupts hormone cycles pretty dramatically. And I was wondering if he has related our culture's penchant for voluntary sleep restriction and, you know, working 24/7 or at least 18 hours a day and just not, you know, short-shifting yourself on sleep.
Yes.
Has any relationship to the hormone disruption you're talking about?
Absolutely, and that's why we do recommend a holistic program. We talk about all of those factors, sleep and rest and reducing stress and all the things that can affect your hormones, because all of those hormones work in concert with each other. And as soon as any one of them gets off, then pretty soon all of them are trying to compensate for each other, and that's when you get into such a mess that doctors really don't even know how to start to disentangle it. So that's why what we do is we recommend a very broad-based health program along with dealing with your thyroid or any other health problems to make sure you're covering the bases.
All right. Thank you very much for that contribution. Bob, let's go to Patty in Moraga. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thanks for the program. I've been diagnosed as moderately hyperthyroid, and that was by a nuclear medicine study. So I'm about ready to take the radioactive tablet that will suppress the thyroid function. Do you think that's an okay thing? What I've had is really loud, forceful heartbeats for the last year, and it's really driving me crazy.
Do you have any history of thyroid in your family, thyroid problems?
Yes, I do. My mother had a goiter, and she had her thyroid, I think, removed at like 30 or something. And I have a multinodular goiter.
Uh-huh. Which many people with autoimmune thyroid, that's how the gland presents itself.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not at all uncommon. To be honest with you, I will let Dr. Shama speak after this, but my feeling about that and from everything I've seen and heard, we would consider the destruction of the gland as a more end-stage treatment than many doctors present it as, and we would recommend trying some of the things that help to slow the gland down naturally first.
Right.
There are some foods and there are some products that are notorious for slowing down thyroid function.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, you don't want to do that because 95% of people with thyroid problems have a slow thyroid and they need it speeded up.
Right.
In your case, however, and there are differing theories about what causes the hyperthyroidism, some doctors actually think that it's a phase on the way to the gland burning out.
So okay.
What you want to do is slow it down. And one of the things that, you know, for instance, cruciferous vegetables such as broccoli and cabbage, cauliflower, those vegetables have an ingredient in them that actually slows down thyroid function. In addition to that, soy products, the tofu and the tempeh and all those products that are made out of soy that we all think are so healthy are very healthy. And for midlife women, they're wonderful for some of the phytoestrogen effect. But if you're a thyroid sufferer And a low thyroid sufferer, you don't want to eat as many servings as most people because they'll slow down your thyroid function. However, if you've got a speedy thyroid, you might try eating some of those foods as and see if that slows it down a little bit.
Sure. And in addition to those, there are vitamins that people take that are benign and very commonly available for very little money. For instance, carnitine is an amino acid that you buy at the health food store. Carnitine in levels above 2.5, 3.5 grams a day will lower your thyroid function. For you, this would be a good side effect to even pursue. And carnitine is a benign item. Quercetin. Quercetin is a bioflavonoid. Equally benign, and people take it for all sorts of reasons. You may want to take quercetin, again, in these same amounts, 3.5, 4.5 grams a day could lower thyroid function. The same thing with the antioxidant alpha-lipoic acid. I use a lot of alpha-lipoic in my medical practice in San Rafael for people that are running a little bit high thyroid and I want to lower it, but without doing the permanent maneuver of doing the radioactive iodine ablation. So alpha-lipoic, 500 milligrams a day, 600, 700 milligrams a day, is enough to lower thyroid function very, very safely. So what Karilee was saying is that there are many maneuvers, even the standard medical maneuver of using the prescription drugs, Tapazole or PTU, might be preferable for this multinodular goiter situation. I have not found people who could explain to me and for my total satisfaction the difference between a Hashimoto's goiter and a multinodular goiter that is right now running a little bit hot. You don't have Graves' disease, the standard reason for people to take radioactive iodine to permanently ablate their gland. Maybe you would want to try some of these less than total and less than permanent maneuvers as a first shot. So I do this in my San Rafael practice with lots of people, and we're often successful. No one in this business bats 1,000, but I tell you, you may want to do something more benign first.
So if you want to reach Dr. Shamus, he can be reached at 866-468-4979.
Okay, look, we're talking obviously to Dr. Richard Shamus and Karilee Shamus, who have a practice in San Rafael. You've got all the numbers. The book is Thyroid Power, the 10 Steps to Total Health. We're here for your questions, 848-4425. Let's go to Joe in Sebastopol. You're on About Health.
Yes, Dr. Lenore, thank you for this great show.
You're welcome.
Sir, could you ask your guests if there's a relationship between osteoporosis and thyroid, low thyroid?
Why don't you ask them?
Oh, okay. Dr. Shamus?
That's a very, very fascinating topic. And, you know, what's so interesting is a lot of our clientele, people who do coaching sessions or come see Dr. Shamus in the office, have told us that when they go to their regular doctor and say, I want to try some thyroid medicine, the doctors will scare them away with one of two problems. They'll say, if you take thyroid medicine, it's going to weaken your bones, or if you take thyroid medicine, it's going to give you heart problems. Well, a lot of times we have not found that to be the case so much as people with low thyroid are already having those problems. So we there may be some relationship that has yet to be further explored, but at this point it makes sense to us that if an absence of thyroid hormone slows down the function of almost every other system and gland and organ in your body, then it might also slow down the formation of bone. And therefore, you could have osteoporosis if you have a thyroid that's not functioning up to snuff. So what we suggest is that you make sure that you are taking the proper amount of thyroid if your body's not making enough or not able to handle it.
All right. Thank you for that question. Let's go to Marilyn in Aptos.
Hi. I wanted to thank you all for this most informative program. And I have a question related to causes of this, what you're almost describing an epidemic here. People using cell phones, I talked to a healthcare person who said they're finding a lot of problems in this whole area of the head, the neck, the throat. What do you know of the impact of that? Because these are radiological devices, cell phones, emitting radio frequency microwave radiation.
Absolutely. And you're bringing up another very critical topic. Of course, it's hard to talk about everything that we spent years writing into our book in one-hour session, but certainly that could be disruptive of the flow in the thyroid area. One of the other things that we're finding is that there, a lot of the chemicals in the environment are actually causing, we believe that they're causing a lot more of the thyroid problems. The pollution of the air, food, and water is so pervasive at this point, and I think that the people who are showing up with thyroid problems are probably what we used to call the canaries in the mines, the people whose bodies are a little more sensitive and are more susceptible to something like this because they have the genetic potential as inherited from someone in the family who also had this problem. I think that cell phones and any of these waves could be causing all kinds of challenges in the body that we're not, we have to do research on all of these, but I can tell you that with almost certainty that the pollution of the air, food, and water, in fact, in many ways, is causing a lot of these epidemics right now that we're having. Almost all of the chronic illnesses that we're seeing can be traced to some kind of pollution overload that the body just can't handle.
Sure, then the thyroid is extremely sensitive to it. The thyroid and adrenal glands are two of the most sensitive of all the body tissues to this air pollution. I think the radio frequencies and microwave frequencies, telephone, cell phone stuff is definitely part of this.
When you say definitely, doctor, there have been a lot of studies looking at this, and you have to at least acknowledge that the preliminary information suggests that there's not much difference in people who use cell phones in terms of some of these pathophysiologic changes. So when you say definitely, that precludes that you've got additional information.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing, Dr. Lenore. Here's what's going on that you do have to let people know. Okay, it's great to have this reassurance. Often we have reassurance from governmental agencies, and there's been reassurance about a lot of things, but it hasn't proven that reassuring because we have an epidemic now. We have an epidemic of these thyroid problems. There are many more multinodular goiters. There's many more people with Hashimoto's. We're talking millions and millions and millions of people, and it's increasing. It's almost increasing in some kind of almost exponentially, and this kind of situation where we have an epidemic, and it's not clear why there is this increase. But we know we have an increase in the pollution factor. We know we have an increase in the radiation
I certainly think the environment contributes to a lot of this. I'm just talking specifically on the cell phone issue, but the environment obviously contributes to a lot of these chronic illnesses. I think we all would acknowledge that.
And we're in agreement on that. And I understand you're wanting to be careful because the research is not out on some of these factors, and probably the cell phone use is one of those, but it would be a wonderful thing to check.
All right, let's go to Avery in Bay Point. You're on About Health.
There, I think my wife passed away due to something like this. When I first met her, she didn't have very much wrong with her, and she had just suddenly gotten a whole bunch of things that they described in this show. And it got written off a lot as obesity-related problems, but she had been fat all her life and not had much wrong with her until all of this happened all of a sudden.
And how old was she?
She had gotten a non-healing wound on her back about 3 years ago, which is usually assumed to be diabetes-related. However, and she did have it, and it was a strong genetic in her family. Even the thinner ones got it eventually. But here's the thing. On the way back from one appointment, in her Lark scooter, she hit a curb wrong and tore up her right arm. The wounds on the arm healed in a week or two, and that wound in her back still remained. Finally, somebody decided to give her some thyroid, and it started healing very quickly. But by that time, she had been downed from exercise and lost all the strength in her legs and broke her leg and died in the surgery to mend it. And I'm wondering how many people are particularly very heavy ones are getting their symptoms written off as something that will never go away because they're fat they might be able to take some this thyroid and wipe them out regardless of whether they lose a lot of weight or not.
I thank you for sharing your story, and I'm so sorry for your loss. That is a very sad story, and we've heard many stories like this. Many times people who are overweight their whole life are blamed and ridiculed unnecessarily because they have a glandular problem that has not been adequately addressed. And then, as you are saying, a lot of times that's compounded by other conditions that people who are overweight are prone to. So it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy and a very tragic one, one that we think could be avoided. And that's why we took the time to write this book, because we think it's unfair and we're very sorry about the situations like this. It makes us, you know, feel badly as health providers that our cohorts and colleagues are not kind of doing a better job with some of this. When there's a wound that won't heal, oftentimes the body just doesn't have the power to heal that. And sometimes that's such a beautiful example of when someone needs something extra that's going to give them a little pump. You know, sometimes people think, well, anyone can take thyroid medicine and it will just help them lose weight or to exercise. They'll want to exercise more or something. You know, that's not really the proper use of thyroid, and it actually doesn't work to make people lose weight unless they need the thyroid medicine in order for the glands to function properly and everything else to work in concert with each other. So you've given us yet one more very tragic example of what we see over and over in today's medical system without being addressed head on. And thank you for your caring.
All right, let's go to Monterey. Talk to Ida. You're on About Health.
Hi, actually, it's Chelsea.
It's Chelsea, okay.
Hi. I hope you haven't already covered this because I just tuned in, but for the past 2 years, I've had really extreme thyroid problems, and my blood tests show that I've been both hyper and hypothyroid at different times. And during the times that I was hypothyroid, I was put on Levoxyl, which when I got worse, the dosage was then doubled, and I had an absolutely terrible reaction to it. And I wondered if you had seen other patients like that, but also I'm now on a bovine thyroid, which helps a little less, but I seem to be tolerating better. So I wondered if you had any experience with that.
One of the things that we mentioned earlier is that, and it's a very important question that you're bringing up, and that is that there are at least 12 different types of thyroid medicine, and most doctors just throw the same medicine at everyone as if that's going to help everyone. And for some reason, our bodies digest, assimilate, and tolerate them differently. So it's really important to learn about the different types of medicine. Sometimes people do best by combining some of the bovine or animal product with some of the synthetic. But also, in addition, you're talking about being hypo and hyper. People who show hypo and hyper at the same time have a very specific condition called hashitoxicosis, and that needs to be treated with some thyroid meds along with something to slow the thyroid down, which is kind of a Japanese protocol. It's an unusual situation, but when it occurs, it can make you feel very crazy.
Sure. What you're describing and what Karilee was naming is a offshoot of the regular kind of thyroid problem. Yours is more unusual, and I would just urge you to check out the Thyroid Power website, www.thyroidpower.com. That is a place where there's a great deal of information for people that have something a little more unusual than just what's standard. I've seen, in my San Rafael practice, I've seen people that have gone to a clinic or gone to an HMO with something that's not quite the standard type of thyroid problem, and it's like a chicken bone in the throat in the regular medical system. They want to handle the regular thing, and everybody gets treated the same way, when these individual and unusual thyroid problems can be handled in a very particular and very successful manner, but individually. For instance, some of what you're describing, Karilee told you about the other kinds of medicines, but also many people who have your kind of condition also have an adrenal difficulty. And when your adrenal gland, which is a little gland above the kidneys that controls our fight or flight and our, you know, energy hormones for stress, the adrenal gland, when it's functioning a little bit off, it will cause the thyroid medicines to not work as well. It'll result in being high and low, and sometimes at the same time. You get to look at the possibility that your situation is a little more unusual, a little bit different, maybe a little adrenal factor. So check out the The website, check out the office phone. Karilee will tell you the office. We have this. It's a 800 number. Go ahead.
What Dr. Shamus does is thyroid coaching with people so that they can then go to their doctors and advocate for better care by saying, here's what I believe I would need and here's what I'd like for you to work on with me. So that number is 866-468-4979.
All right, let's go to Lisa and Vallejo. You aren't about health.
Hi, I had cancer about 5 or 7 years ago, and ever since I had my entire thyroid removed, the doctor has kept me on a little bit low because they want to still be able to detect the cancer if it comes back, and that puts me at a higher risk for osteoporosis, and I don't know what else, but I'm wondering what you think about being regularly on a low thyroid medicine.
Well, sure. What chances are what they're doing is giving you a very low TSH. You know, this is a level of medicine that your TSH is what's low. And then they check for the return of thyroglobulin. It's a different test, but they can test for the kind of the protein that the thyroid gland tissue would make. So if there's any thyroid tissue that's come back, then they would check your thyroglobulin level and be able to see it very easily because your TSH is very low. There shouldn't be much activity. That is a fairly standard approach, but an earlier caller talked about the difficulty of living a normal life when you don't have a full oomph that the medicine should be giving you, but in some cases does not. Synthetic thyroxine, synthetic T4, a Synthroid, is what almost everybody gets. And is that what you're on?
Levoxyl, I think that's
that's the same. All right, that's a different brand of the same thing, and that's a very good medicine, but it only has T4. And as we mentioned earlier, sometimes you need the T3 along with the T4, especially if you don't have a thyroid gland. Or many people need T1 and T2, which only comes from natural thyroid, which are armor thyroid or animal glandular thyroid. So those mixed with the medicine that you're on now could have you feeling a whole lot better and further decrease the risk of the return of cancer, because you would have a better, stronger system and be able to fight things off and, you know, have more search and destroy missions from your immune system to make sure any wayward cells are dealt with. So I urge you to, you know, check this out a little more fully. You're on the right track to be even thinking about it in this critical way.
So it'd still be good to be low? If I'm on a different type of medicine?
Well, it's a little hard to understand what their rationale is. Some doctors are concerned that if you have a fast-growing cancer, that sometimes the thyroid can actually increase the speed of your cancer growth. So, it's, you know, that gets you into a whole specialized category that you might do well to consult personally.
All right. Well, certainly thank you very much, Dr. Shamus, for both Richard Shamus, MD, and Dr. Karilee Shamus, both with tremendous interest and commitment to exposing the thyroid gland as one of the culprits in a number of very common diseases. I congratulate you on your work, and I'm certainly excited by your successes. I think any time you have this much commitment to any one entity, I think that certainly gives you the necessary tools to become more than expert on it, and I think you have surrounded it with a number of helpful aids. So why don't we give the website and the phone numbers again, please?
Yes, that website is www.thyroid, T-H-Y-R-O-I-D, power, one word, thyroidpower.com, and the phone number, toll-free, is 866-468-4979. And Dr. Lenore, we thank you for your commitment to allowing people to learn more about their health.
Absolutely. Getting a chance to hear different opinions is wonderful. So keep up the good work.
Well, thank you very much. And so I'd like, for that good work, I'd like to thank my producer, Rangita Geisler, who does such a great job of contacting people we think you'd like. And I'd like to thank the Ethnic Health Institute for the support that they give to our program. But most of all, I'd like to thank you for joining us for another edition of About Health. Remember that health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Michael Knorr. We'll talk again next week.
Why should the black man in America concern himself, since we've been away from the African continent for 400 years, 300 or 400 years? Why should we concern ourselves? What impact does what happened to them have upon us? Number one.
For news, information, and analysis about Africa and the African diaspora, tune in weekly on Mondays at 7 p.m. to Africa Today with your host, Walter Turner. Africa Today is your source for being up to date on Africa and African. Mondays at 7 p.m. Africa Today on your Pacifica radio station, KPFA 94.1 FM.
This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. It's 3 o'clock. Stay